You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple, and beyond. Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 164, Elf Trying to Burn the Sun. And coming to you from the burning up suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, I'm your co-host, John Omicron Mottola.
Oh, it's the Omicron variant of Mottola.
Yes, that's right, folks. Your co-host with the co-most has finally succumbed to the Rona.
And he's been off work all day, but they've able to cook up lines like that.
You're not lying. I had nothing to do. It's for like, I've been out of work since Friday. So, today is Monday and I still have a few days to go. I've been cooped up in this house and luckily it's at this point, it's not that bad. It hasn't been fun exactly, but it was bound to happen eventually. So
yeah, it seems to be the common review. Like, well, I mean, at least being vaccinated and everything seems to have helped the severity. I know people who got it pre-vaccine that were wishing for death. And I was just like, I felt crappy for a couple of days. It was definitely worse things, but
2 years I was able to avoid it. So good record. Good record.
Cheers to you for that.
I mean, I'm gonna try for another two.
Yes, please. Or infinite number of years. But
well, yeah, that would be nice. So I mean, I'd asked my doctor about it. Because I said, is there a way to tell which variant it is? If it's Delta, Omicron. So I thought I had Omicron, and he said that no, it can't be, because the that variant only comes from the Omicron region of France. So otherwise, it's just he says that I have sparkling COVID. Hi-yo!
He has been working on material, folks. Oh man, give this guy a few days off of work and he just comes in with this smoking hot material he's testing out.
I had nothing else to do today. Oh, you saw that one coming from a mile away too, didn't you? Because that's not a new one.
I didn't know. I've heard that one before. It's a good one. It's a good one.
I know. I read it. I was researching lines this afternoon.
He was Googling COVID zingers.
I saw that one, completely forgot about it, and I like fell off my chair laughing. I'm like, oh, that one's going in the episode. So
well, you sound great. You don't sound too out of it. I know we've been obviously texting, and it sounded like you had a crappy couple of days, but yeah, like on the mend, which is good.
Yeah, pretty rough weekend, and like getting up, like waking up is just like not. Yeah, it takes me a while to get going, but around this time of day, which, for us, it's like 6, 7 PM, in the US, and it's, I'm usually good around now, but, I feel like I got over the hump. So, it's just, resting and, waiting to get back to work and then not being in a infectious anymore. So.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, it's been super hot here, like unseasoned. It was in the 90s. Yeah. It was 96 the other day. They said it was like the hottest it's been, the earliest it's been in 80 something years. so yeah, 96 is like 36 basically Celsius for those.
Yeah, basically starting over here, like the past couple of days, it went from like, like every day it got progressively hotter until today it was like, What did I text you like 10 o'clock this morning? And I was like, it was already like 83 degrees, which is, it's pretty, it's pretty warm over here. So that's why I'm wearing the tank top and had some windows open. And just when I was feeling up to it, doing some chores around the house, planning my upcoming time off, like doing the research and everything. So when, you know, when else do you have time to do it? So like, so I'm like, oh, you know, see this and I'll book that and I'll get in touch with people and see if this is okay and find out this thing, you know, stuff that you usually don't do because you're like, I don't have time.
Yeah, that's kind of the one. I think that was kind of the biggest wake up for me when I had COVID was, you know, like I felt lousy for, there is that music again.
I don't hear it.
What is going on? It's like, it sounds like a commercial. Where, I'm looking at my computer, where could it be coming from?
Like a, maybe a pop-up?
It's loud. It's like really loud. But I mean, it couldn't be. I don't have any browsers open.
I am definitely not getting it.
We got it right before we started up, and then I got it again. Well, it's going to be edited out of this show, so I guess. Maybe that's just going to happen every 10, 15 minutes. Drive me freaking bananas. But hopefully it's not on the video. I don't know why it keeps happening. It sounds like one of those little like 3 or 4 second promo things with these really loud music. Let me just open my task manager here. See if I can figure out what it is. Oh, I don't see anything in my task manager that would lead me to believe it was that. Very bizarre. Yeah, but I think when I had COVID, it was like, you know, the first few days of feeling lousy, but not like, you know, just lie down and watch a movie lousy, not anything worse than that. But then after a while, I was like, wow, man, like, you know, just kind of, I needed that reset, you know, of just being like, well, you can't do anything. You can't go anywhere. It's like, I kind of wish like that happened like a couple, 2-3 times a year where it's just like, okay, you need to take the next, maybe not 10 days, but 5 days. You don't leave the house. You don't do anything. You don't go anywhere. You don't work. You don't. It's just like I came out of that. I went back to work, even though I was exhausted probably for like 3 weeks after that. Just so tired. Like I went back to work and I went up the stairs to my office. And I was like, I'm just gonna rest. I'm leaning against this wall for about a few minutes. But I felt fine other than that. So it's like I think every so often you just need to like to shut everything off and all the expectations and everything and just kind of relax. So it was kind of it was a good mental break anyway.
Yes.
But if you felt really bad, like some of the people I talked to were like, it was the worst I've ever felt for 2 weeks. And like, yeah, that is not good.
Oof, no, I would say 1 or 2 days. I was just useless on the first day. It was like, forget it.
Yep. The first day I had it at work. I knew, and I was like, I took a test and it came back negative. And I was like, I feel really bad. Like maybe it's the flu if it came back negative. And I was just like at work and I was like, I don't know what to do. Like, do I stay? Like, I feel like I shouldn't stay. I don't want to get myself sick. And then I left and that's when I got the test and I was like, oh shit. But what can you do? That's all behind us now. All right. So this week. If you want to help support the show this week or any week, you can do so in a number of ways. One is to leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. 2 is you can buy some merch at our Etsy store. 3, you can become a patron on Patreon or PayPal or Cash App. Any way that you want for as little as $1 a month. Or if you just want to give us a lump sum payment, that'll count as a monthly donation and you'll get the 4 episodes in a row credit and you can be happy with that, whatever you'd like.
You're really excited about that Cash App. Oof.
Yeah, Cash App. I keep hyping the Cash App. I think I might just stop mentioning it because nobody's using it, so, which is fine. Patreon and PayPal are still hotbeds, so we'll take it. So speaking of people who support our show, let's thank our executive level patrons coming in at the $25 Uncommon Man tier. We have Ovis Nakvi. At the £10 tier, Dr. Jill Brees. At the Turn It Up to $11 tier, we have Clay Wambacher, Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Alan Ain't Too Proud to Beg, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 someone came tier, Ryan M., Jeff Bryce, Victor Campos, Better Call Saul Evans, and Kev Roberts and his wonderful children, Matthew, Gareth, and Sarah. Thank you to the whole Roberts clan for that. Frank Thielgard Mortensen joining us in the Discord today for the first time. So for those of you that want to join up, if you become a patron, you get exclusive access to our patrons-only Discord. Lots of lively chat going on, a lot of characters in there, including Frank Thielgard Mortensen now. And today, as we record this, it's very fitting for the subject matter. It is the anniversary of Ronnie James Dio's passing. So it was a lot of commentary in there about that. And it just kind of worked out that way that we have a Ronnie James Dio selection, because this isn't going to air. This is going to air way after that. So, but you just mentioned, hey, it's Ronnie's anniversary. I was like, oh yeah,
mm-hmm.
worked out pretty well.
Yeah. Nice to be discussing Ronnie on the anniversary of his passing, 12th anniversary.
Yeah. Not a fun anniversary to celebrate, but
some great way to honor him.
We will honor him for sure. One thing happened recently, and that is,
ooh,
right, you see that wrist movement there? That's how you play the flexitone, folks. That's right, we got a new Apple Podcast review, a new 5-star review, and whenever we get a 5-star review, we play the Mark Nauseef commemorative flexitone, even though he's still alive. I guess, can you commemorate, or it's not a memorial for him, but it's the on, like the Mark
Nauseef memorial flexitone.
It's his signature, signature, like they do, flexitone, like signature guitars and signature basses. This is like custom design. He's like, well, I wanted to make sure that the bend in the metal was just right to suit my thumb, so I put this little divot here. You really get that really good effect when you get that. But this review comes to us from the USA by someone named Frozen Brews. 5 stars. Title: Love This Podcast. Back in 1974, when I was 13 years old, I was at my friend's house shooting pool when he played the album Burn. I was hooked, and they became my favorite band. So I have been a fan for 48 years. My wife told me she's going to play Smoke at the Water at my funeral. It sounds like a threat. Careful, Frozen. I really enjoy the fact that Nathan and John are musicians and are able to explain like how something is being played, how it's recorded, how difficult it is to play or a particular song part, etc. For so many years, I felt like I was the only person who liked Deep Purple. Back in the Stone Age, when I was in high school, I had friends who wanted to ride around in my car with me. They knew that there was a price to pay if they did. They had to listen to Deep Purple. So glad this podcast exists. I really enjoy listening to Nathan and John. They sound like two guys that I could really enjoy hanging out with. Great job, great conversation, lots of humor, all while listening to Deep Purple. 5 stars. Well, thank you, Frozen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I appreciate that. That's great. That's a really nice review. You sound like somebody we'd like to hang out with, and we will get to hang out every week with you when you listen to the podcast. It's just like hanging out with old friends you never knew before. I think we should mention we've been in talks. We're probably going to buy the tickets in the next couple days, but John is going to come up for his annual, what will now be referred to as his annual September visit to headquarters for his headquarters performance review.
I'm going to come in with a clipboard, glasses at the rim of my nose. All right, let's see.
Your annual review. We can sign new contracts. He's going to negotiate his salary, all that sort of stuff.
My God, is it going to be like a year already then?
I know, because it was September last time he came up, right?
Jeez.
Crazy, right? Yeah. They were just starting to work on my siding. Now you can actually see what it looks like without like crap all over my backyard and patio and front yard and every other thing.
Oh, actually, that's right, because it was unseasonably warm. And then I remember like a couple of days after I left, you had Fall Fest, where it was like, you know, a 1,000 degrees out. And you're just like, yeah, face painting, candy apples, and like, yeah, you know. In bathing suits, you know, like everybody was dying.
It was like pumpkin picking and every other thing. Hay rides. It's like riding hay ride. You need to put on sunscreen and you're sweating.
Oh.
Can I wear, you're not wearing like a flannel. You're wearing like flannel shorts and a tank top. It's just, yeah, I forgot about that.
Well, it was hard to remember, because I was like, in my mind, I'm like, was that the summer? Because I just remember like everywhere we went, I was wearing like shorts and a tank top. It was like warm out.
It was still like early enough, or it was mid whatever September. So it was, you know, it was that time. It can be nice and warm at that time. It probably still will be again.
Good.
Yeah, we'll go see Whitesnake. And expect a full show review. And
it's our next stop.
All the reviews are coming in from Europe, and there was talk about that in the Discord today. It looks like Art Smith went last night, and I think Frank was saying he's going in a few days or a few weeks or something. So it's making its way through Europe. So we're hearing some early reviews in. So that should be a lot of fun to hear. So all right. So you know what time it is now on the show, which seems to be an almost weekly occurrence. That's right, folks. It's time for Postcards from the Edge. I almost said Podcasts from the Edge. Podcasts from the Edge of Connecticut. That's right. This postcard comes to us from who's it from this week? Let me see. Oh, Peter Gardeau. What do you know?
The only man in the world who owns any postcards. He has them all, folks.
This is the one he sent. I think he showed this to us on the live stream that we did. And that was almost a year ago, too. Which is it's a little bear holding. Must be like the Capitol building in Berlin. It says Berlin underneath, and it's like a bear holding up the Capitol building.
That's great.
Comes to me, and it's the best part is it's written entirely in Dymo labels.
Wow, that's the most Gardeau thing that you could possibly get.
It is, and I sent I texted you two, and I texted Gardeau a couple nights ago. Went out with some friends, like first time we've been out without the kids, like I don't know, 6 months, and probably longer than that. 6 months ago we had COVID. It was long before that, before the holidays. But anyway, we went out, and the server brought over like a thing of condiments, and they were all labeled with, it looked like Dymo label, but it was like imitation Dymo label. It wasn't actually punched into the plastic. And this is the real deal. So this comes to us dated. This actually took a while to get here because I got it just the other day, and it was dated at just a couple days after Easter.
Oh, wow.
I think what happened is that somebody at the post office saw this and was like, is this like some sort of freaking code or ransom note?
It looks like a ransom note, yeah.
So it says, it's very short. It says, Nate, podcast, in quotes, did not stick to my hat, Pete. I think he's referring to, remember we had podcasts. Was it when we were in Florida and he was trying to stick podcasts to his hat?
I think
so,
yeah.
Time he was trying to make it stick to his hat. Thank you, Peter Gardeau. It's always great to get a postcard from you. It looks like you need a little extra postage for the weight of these Dymo labels.
Maybe that's why it took so long.
Exactly. All right. Well, always good to get some postcards on the show. And you know, it's Peter's one of our, gotta stop this Cole Porter here. it didn't want to die. It was like, no, I'm turning the volume back up. All right. So yeah, if you want to support, we are part of the Deep Dive Podcast Network, tons of shows on the Deep Dive Podcast Network. Check out our show notes and our page for more details, but check out some of those other great shows. And we'll be on our merry way here. So with that, we have the album in hand. Like you said, we're recording this on the anniversary of Ronnie's passing 12 years ago today. We had just so happened, we had agreed to do this this album before we even realized that. And it's a Ronnie album. Going to close out the Elf catalog, the final Elf album. And that's Trying to Burn the Sun. John, what's your history with this album?
So I want to say that this is probably the last Elf album that I did get. I'm almost sure of it because I know that I didn't know of it. Just kind of going in line with how I was finding out about albums and records and everything those days, I was just buying things as I was finding them. So I had no idea if Elf had like two albums or 20, you know? Mm-hmm. Pretty sure I was in like, you know, one of the used record stores or tape stores or whatever. And I had like, I mean, when you look at the cover, I mean, it's unmistakable who it is. And when I saw that, I'm like, oh my God, that's another Elf album. And I like grabbed it. I'm pretty sure it was cassette. It's one of, it remains to be one of my favorite Elf albums to this day, because, in keeping with you not having that with the other Elf albums, it set itself apart too from, like, as we're going to hear it, being like a little bit musically a little bit different as well. And mm-hmm. You know, maybe it was kind of you know, a sign or something like that, but yeah, this has been one of my favorites.
Awesome. And I think we talked about this on the show too. I think we've mentioned before that this is one of your favorites by Elf. And the more I look at it, I've made a purpose of not listening to it. I can't remember if I know I didn't have this one. I only had the first two. And I don't know if I've ever heard this. I think I have. And maybe when I hear it, it'll jog my memory. But I don't have like a solid, I really have really vivid memories of the first two, and I don't on this one. But my kind of memory was like, I feel like this one was them taking a little more of a step towards what we would be more into. So yeah, I'm looking forward to listening to it again for maybe the first time, but at least the first time in a long time. And on this album, we've got, the same lineup. We've got Craig Gruber on bass, Gary Driscoll on drums, Steve Edwards on guitar, Mickey Lee Sewell on keyboards, Mark Nossif on percussion, Ronnie James Dio on vocals. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Mark Nossif on percussion. And Ronnie James Dio, of course, on vocals. Additionally, you've got the... I feel like they should have a name. Didn't they have a name on one of the albums? But Helen Chappelle, Barry St. John, Liza Strike, the great trio from Butterfly Ball, from Play Me Out, from early White Snake, and everything in between, Pink Floyd, you name it. They've been on all sorts of albums. They're just incredible. And I think they were on the previous, I think they were on Carolina County Ball, at least on a track or two, but amazing singers. And then our good friend Martin Ford back, the Mountain Fjord Orchestra is what they're called on this one. And we talked with Roger a little bit about that when we met him a couple months ago about Martin Ford and Mountain Fjord and Martin Fjord and all the various pseudonyms that they had for that group.
Mm-hmm.
On technical, we've got Lou Austin from as engineer from Butterfly Ball, and previous he did the Marlin and Roger Glover stuff. He did, what else did he do? He did the previous Elf, I think. And then of course the producer is Roger Glover himself. So not a bad lineup. You've got a pretty much the original Rainbow lineup minus Ritchie and the great backing singers and Martin Fjord and Roger Glover. I mean, what more could you hope for?
Ritchie.
There you go. Ritchie refused to play honky tonk.
Yeah, that's shoe shine music.
Exactly. Okay, so here we go. Album art. John, what do you think about this? What do you think of this album cover?
I've always really dug this album cover because it's the... I don't know if it's like a sunset I always looked at it as like it was like maybe a sunset or an eclipse or just some kind of something out in the stratosphere. I want to think it's a sunset, and there's Ronnie inside of it swinging the boom mic Coverdale style.
Yeah.
I think that it pretty much cemented two things, is that number one, Ronnie was the star of the show. And number two, it kind of, I don't know, consciously or not, kind of like takes on another meaning of like, this is like the final Elf album, almost like it's the sunset of like the Elf album. They're going like the way he's like leaning back and trolling the mic, it's like going out in a blaze of glory type of thing. With the red and the orange and everything, it's... really cool cover. Even though, like, I mean, if you look at it, I'm tempted to think like for a while, I thought it was kind of cheesy because, you know, you have those like 70s album covers that look really almost kind of like thrown together where they just like, oh, let's just put a picture of like one of the guys or two of the random guys on the front, you know, type of thing. And it's like, okay, weird. But I don't know. I mean, it's not like they put like I don't know, like Mark Nossif on the front or something.
Just Mark Nossif.
I'm just thinking Nossif. Of somebody like
has saved 150 million plastic bottles from entering the environment.
You hear it?
Flo's package is 100% recyclable and more than 68% renewable. Flo protects its springs, extracting just 2% of its renewable water. Flow is committed to being carbon negative by 2025.
Are we not,
Flow alkaline spring water. Water that's kinder to your body and the planet.
Oh, and I don't know how to stop it.
Here we go, folks, from our sponsor, Flow Water.
It just... Yeah, guys, I gotta take a second to just tell you about Flow Water. Like, look at this. Oh, this, I got some in the glass right here. Oh my God, best water I've ever had. I don't know. This has never happened before, and I don't know how to make it stop. It's very strange.
There's gotta be something open in the background or something that's playing like an ad.
But I literally reset my computer right before we started, so I'm like, I don't know what's going on. So,
yeah.
Very odd. I don't know. Do I have malware on my computer that's just like pumping in ads? Like, I don't get it.
That would be my first guess. But
all right. Well, we might get a few more of those before the show's over. So
hopefully not while we're listening to a song.
It's while I'm sharing my. So it's definitely coming from this computer. Without like doing some troubleshooting, I have no idea how to even figure it out. But anyway, this is the album cover. It's a great album cover. Yep. I love it too. I definitely think it's a sunset. Never thought about the sun setting on their career. That's a great observation. It's really good. It's simple. Photography and design by Finn Costello, which really just a really solid album cover. No frills. It's kind of, I can't tell if that's from the, you have the actual album in front of you. So is it that, it, does it have that graininess to it on the album cover or is that just like,
I would say,
and it's probably because it was that close up on the sun and obviously they had to blow it up so much. You get this kind of noise, the image. It's not like a super clear, like it's clearly a photograph. It's again, one of those situations where it's like weird that they didn't just do a painting because, you know, it would have been simple to capture as a painting, but
the big yellow one's the sun.
the yellow one's the sun.
All right. But I also think it's kind of an unusual pose too, because that's not a usual stance that Ronnie would ever take on stage. Like, I don't think that I've seen him ever do that very often. Like, I never known him to like swing around the mic stand type of thing.
Yeah. And like you said, it's very, very Coverdale.
Yeah. It's like very not typical of what at least we have known him to do. Although maybe that was a go-to move for him back then for a little while. Who knows? It's still very cool though.
Maybe Coverdale got it from him watching.
Still very like powerful looking pose.
Exactly. Yeah. That's great stuff. Okay, so let's close that out. Oh, actually, no, you got the back cover. The back cover is kind of more of the same. It says, I'm a fire burning higher, trying to burn the sun on that, what looks to be that same image. And then it's just got the list of the all the people that we just mentioned as far as the talent and then the track listing. So there you go. That's the label on the album itself. MGM Records. That's it. It's trying to burn the sun. We kind of talked about and discussed the photography and who's on the album. So there you go. All right. Before we get into this album, we have to do one thing. And what is that? Well, that is to thank our core level patrons. Coming in at the $7.77 Keep It Warm Rat tier, we have Michael Vader. At the episode $6.66 tier, Steve Coldwell, Arthur Smith, Anton Glaving, Mike Catan, and Richard Fusey. At the $6.65 Almost Evil tier, we have Kenny Wymore. At the $5.99 Nice Price tier, we have Fielding Fowler, Robert Smith, Peter from Illinois, Michael Bagford, and Carl Helberg. Not relation to Mitch Hedberg or Mitch Helberg. At the $5 Moneylender tier, we have John Convery, German Heindel, Adrian Hernandez, Jesper Elman, Alexi the Perfect Stranger Slepikoff, James North, Mark Hodgetts, Will Porter, Zwapper the Electric Alchemist, Tim Southern Cross Johnson, and of course, someone that actually just wrote in to give me the new name and I didn't put it in the spreadsheet. So that is, oh, you gotta give me 1 second here. This, the new name that this person is deciding on is,
hurry up.
I'm looking. Oh,
sorry.
Well, he didn't get back to me with the official thing, but we're calling him Percival Frequency.
I'm sorry. That's good.
So we'll see. If
he, I like wants, that.
If he wants to adjust it any more than that, but Percival Frequency, I'm writing in the show notes right now, so I don't forget. So thank you to all of you for your generous support of the Deep Purple podcast. We could not do it without you. All right. So with hopefully all malware behind us and a fresh, clean slate of where we can start this stuff up for, are you, John, ready to start listening to some, are you ready to start to try to burn the sun? That was really poorly said.
I think I'll answer that like this.
Okay, he's doing the Ronnie pose with the boom stand from the doing album cover, and which I believe would probably mean he is 100% ready. So here we go.
Always ready for Ronnie. Does a bear shit in the woods? The answer is yes.
does a bear try to burn the sun? All right, here we go. Let's try to burn the sun with the opening track, Black Swampy Water. Some classic Elf bright piano.
Yep.
Some very nice cowbell from Mr. Driscoll there.
Now, listening to this opening riff, if you told me that that was Ritchie playing guitar, I would say yes, because that is a Ritchie.
The little octave thing.
100%, yeah, yep. But it's so awesome. Yeah, that's good. A little more volume.
Yeah, so this is like that same honky-tonk, boogie-woogie sort of stuff, but with a little more of an edge to it.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was going to say. You could tell that Ronnie has definitely found like the voice he's going to move forward with.
Yep. I think we've got the ladies singing back up on that already. This sounds like David Coverdale's White Snake. Like, it sounds like it could be, well, I mean, probably because it's produced by the same guy. It's got the same orchestrations. It's got the same backup singers.
But I definitely think they hit on the winning formula here. Like you said, it's that same kind of like steeped in that same honky tonk type of style, but it has more edge to it now because you got all the same people, Glover producing, all the same musicians. I think it took them a couple of albums to kind of finally get there.
In Black Swampy Water, that's where I caught her.
Yeah, I never understood the title of the song.
Caught an alligator?
Just some great rock. Even this kind of sounds kind of like, if you told me that Ritchie played that, I would have been like, yeah, I believe that.
Steve Edwards was good, and he that was it for him after Elf. I mean,
yeah.
Nice little slowdown there. It's like almost offbeat sort of groove. But I can imagine it must have been a traumatic experience for him to just have somebody come in and say, my band now, you out. You know, like, just, it was like a hostile takeover. And it was like by like who was considered to be the greatest rock guitarist in the world at that moment.
Poor guy.
I mean, that's a crummy situation, but I'm surprised he didn't try to do anything else at all. Oh, sounds like You Fool No One from the drums.
Nice quick fade out.
Very, very, very quick fade out there.
Nice kind of melody going on there too. The it's a nice nice counter melody there.
Yeah, fantastic. All right. What do you think of Black Swampy Water? The song, not the
the song, not the stuff.
Not the,
not the actual water itself.
Looks like I just reminded John that the spreadsheet existed.
Oh, me and the spreadsheet. What are you gonna do with me?
John's like, no, I knew the whole time. I'm just stalling.
Jeez, all right, God, I wasn't even at the bottom. Can you believe that? I think I was messing around in here doing something else the last time.
Fumbling with those tabs.
All right, Black Swampy Water. That was a strong opener. I'm gonna give that one a 4.
Mm-hmm.
Love the way that it started out this this final Elf album. So definitely I said everything that I had to say during the song. It's just like a great mix of like everything that Elf does, but I think you put it the best, with more edge. And of course Ronnie sounds fantastic. You know, I don't think it wouldn't have been the same song without him. That's one of the things that these albums too can have, all the same kind of like good 70s sounding music. But I mean, Ronnie being the vocalist just elevated it. You know, I mean, that's no two ways.
Absolutely. I agree 100%. Give it a 4 as well. If memory serves me correctly, with the previous Elf albums, they've started strong and then kind of, it's been fatiguing after a while. Like there was a lot of sameness to them. Right. And I mean, not unique to Elf. There's quite a few. I think one of the things doing the show has made me realize is it takes a really special band, not just a special band, but a special band in a special situation to create an album that moves along in a way and is sequenced in a way that can kind of really keep you interested in the format of listening to it like this, because, it can be fatiguing if it sounds very same and if the energy is not quite there. And they certainly started with the right amount of energy. It sounds great. Let's see what else they have in store for us with the next track, Prentice Wood. Tense hi-hat work there.
So keeping up the pace, keeping up the energy. Like how it builds. Almost like a train kept a rolling type of thing.
Oh yeah.
I love this song. It's got such a great groove.
And this is all these songs are written by Dio and Sewell.
Yeah.
I think we talked on the last album, the LA 59 cover had them, the two of them predominantly on the cover, with the others smaller. They were the kind of the songwriting duo.
Yeah, these verses just have like the perfect like groove to it.
A lot of nice little variations there in the drums. Sounds like this is a song about watching soccer, watching guys play soccer. Talking about English, English countryside, hitting the ball around.
Could be. And I like how they kind of the bigness that the chorus of the backup singers brings to the chorus, the group of singers brings to the chorus, really just like, you know, makes it really big.
A very strange turn, almost sounds like the song's over. Your birds chirping. love that they have that level of dynamics. You can almost not hear what's going on right now.
Mm-hmm. Almost foreshadowing something that would sound like a rainbow. It's a little bit medieval sounding. Yeah. But that doesn't last too long. Kicks right back into it. I love that. I mean, that rhythm section is crazy. Like, the just a great bass line, and the drums are doing, like, really just cool stuff there in the background. Yeah, almost has like an Allman Brothers type feel to it.
Oh yeah, it does. Good call.
Hey, there's a lot of great stuff going on in this song.
Wow.
Ah, they faked us out.
When they were doing that, like, I thought, I was like, wow, they're gonna make this last for like the last minute of the song. They're gonna like hitting cymbals and everything.
Now hearing these first couple of songs, do you know yet if you've heard the album before or no?
It's not sounding super familiar, other than
okay,
because it has an elvish sound to it. It sounds weird. It doesn't sound super familiar. Like maybe I'd listen to it a couple of times and okay. I don't know, but digging the energy, and you could hear, it's so fun. You could hear those background singers in the low distance. And breaking news, Art Smith just posted in Discord and with a picture of David Coverdale and says, Whitesnake were great. Don't listen to social media. DC is still the best.
Hell yeah. We know
that's
it.
Right. But he doesn't sound exactly like he did when he was 25.
Interesting. Well, I got news for you, buddy. So anybody that says that, you should just go over and just like grab their belly and be like, this isn't like when you were 25 either. Jiggle it.
I can do it to myself. This doesn't look like it used to look. I used to be able to see my feet.
Yeah, but you're not insulting Coverdale, so
exactly.
We won't do that to you.
I wouldn't dream of it, darling. All right. What would you do?
Behave.
What would you give Prentice Wood?
All right, so I was thinking about it.
I just think it was just Prentice Wood. I just keep thinking like morning wood. It's just like Prentice Wood. It's like obviously like a forest, but like I'm Googling it. You know what I need to do? I need to go to Google Maps.
Hey Beavis, I woke up today with Prentice Wood.
Let's see. I'm gonna type in Prentice Wood and see if anything comes up.
Is it like a saying or a meaning or what? What?
The first thing that came up is a contractor. Contractor in Minnesota? No, Wisconsin.
Yeah.
It's on Prentice Street, but it's called Wood Beaver. Because I see two things. I see a Prentice stove installation in very north Scotland, it looks like, and okay. Then Prentice and Jackson Limited Pallet Company. So I guess it's not a place.
I think that maybe taking a look at the lyrics may unlock the meaning of that. Like,
yeah. Well, I mean, yeah. Looking at it, it seemed to be like, you know, watching the flowers grow, feeling the magic in the air. Jump the net and change sides again. It sounds like a soccer game. Hit the ball around like he's going to watch like
like maybe it's
a Purple play soccer between shows or something.
Maybe. Or Prentice Wood, like, you know, maybe it's like a park or a woods, or it's maybe it's a place. I always felt like it was a place.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I mean, you'd think there'd be some sort of like reference to it, but anyway, yeah. Prentice Wood, how do you rank it?
All right. So like I was saying, I was like, I'm very familiar with this song. It's probably one of my favorites, and hearing it now, I like it better than I ever have. Five.
Oh, oh
my God. Bring out the big guns. Hi-yo.
I feel like we need something to do when we get a five. Like,
well, wow. Flexitone will have to do for now, but, and Mark Nosseeff is on the album, so it makes it appropriate.
We might get some somewhere.
But I think everything from like, I mean, you got a great opener, and then for Elf to come in with this high energy, they just kick right into this rock song where it just kind of layers for about like 30 seconds and then just kicks into this like great groove. Ronnie and the backup singers are just nailing it. And then boom, they drop out. And I want to say it's not even a minute of like this really soft, like dynamic type of thing, which could have easily gone on for like 3-4 minutes.
Yeah. If this was a Pink Floyd song, that would have been like 4 minutes in the middle
right.
of like a 15 minute song.
Turned it into this boring ass song. And then boom, they go right back into it. Like I said, there's a couple of false things like that. Like there's that false, like slow down in the middle, the false ending all the gospel singers. This really cool kind of like, and this is actually the first time I heard a kind of an Allman Brothers-esque type of like solo, kind of like the I always call it an Iommi type soloing, because like he was really one of the, I don't know, it probably wasn't the first, but one of those that would like layer guitar parts that were like slightly off when he would do solos on his early albums and like, you know, from each other. And then they would kind of, you know, meet up at the end sometimes, or sometimes they just stayed disjointed. But yeah, just really great guitar work. And I don't know, it's just like this great high energy song with a great groove. And I love it. One of my faves.
Awesome. And for those of you keeping track, that's John's first five since the back-to-back fives of Running White Face City Boy and Are You Sure off of Glory Road. So
wow. Okay. Yeah,
my fives goes back way further than that. So I'm very overdue for a five here. But this is not going to be the one for me. I like the song a lot. I think it's a solid four for me. Keeps up that great energy from the first song. And yeah, it's a great, like, so far it's just this is the side of Elf that I think we wanted to see. And I know I never had a copy of this, because if I did, I would have, Carolina County Ball is the one that I heard the most, and I know that I would have, that would have been moved over in favor of this so far from what I've heard. So okay, next track up is a song called When She Smiles. It's a little anticlimactic. I timed it so well for this. There we go. This little distort sounds like maybe a Fender Rhodes. So it's only four songs per side, so they're bringing down a little bit after those two rockers.
Yeah, they slow it down a little bit, but it's not like a full-on ballad.
Right. Nice like down home sort of bluesy,
and I like so far, like, if the for the first few songs they're building again. They started with the piano, the organ, whatever. Now they just have, and then Ronnie, now they just have the drums, and then they're gonna bring in the rest of the band.
Nice. Ronnie getting out the rhyming dictionary.
Like that line, looks like you swallowed your shoes. What the hell are you talking about?
I'm telling you, just had his rhyming dictionary out. This is great. This is like not going at all where you think it's going to go.
No. You got the Mountain Fjord Orchestra kicking in.
Almost a discordant note, like high up on the keys.
You know, I never noticed that with the piano before.
Nice. It was like a discordant high notes on the Fender Rhodes, and then there was a piano on like the left channel low in the mix also doing something discordant and high. Very interesting effect. Only Ronnie could deliver that line to make it sound like magic. Not a great line. That was cool. Classic Ronnie ad-libbing at the end here.
Like, she makes me feel good when she's waving bye-bye. You're just like, well, wait like, a minute.
Wait, do you like her or not? Yay, so she's leaving.
So you end the song and you're just like, so somebody swallowed their shoes and the only way you're happy is when she's getting the hell out of here? Like, so I guess you don't like her? Like, what's happening?
Sounds like he likes her from everything he's saying.
But you're right. Ronnie can sing the most ridiculous lyrics and it sounds like fantastic.
You know, he doesn't do that. You know, this whole like, and my baby, she left me on the top of the line. When he's doing all that sort of stuff, he doesn't really do that in Dio. You know what I mean? Like that ad libby outro stuff that he throws in all over the place. We've seen it in Elf and in Rainbow and in Butterfly Ball. And that the track he did on Wizards Convention, like this early Ronnie stuff, he's always throwing in these like ad libby stuff that doesn't, you know, oh, backs to the wall, all this sort of stuff. Like, am I wrong? Like, you know, Dio a lot better than I do. So like, does he do that in Dio?
I can't really think of anything because I feel like by that time, the compositions were more like geared toward heavy metal.
Right.
You know what I mean? Almost. So it was like, I don't know that there was really a, like an opportunity for him to do that. I'm trying to think like going through like really quick in my head, if there are any like songs like that. I mean, there are a lot of songs where he would during the outro, he would be like, not riffing really, but like doing that kind of thing. But I don't think it was as improvised.
Yeah.
Or it didn't feel as improvised as some of this stuff. And it probably fit in better because in the 80s, if he was like, your back's against the wall, you'd be like, well, yeah, you know, because he's probably fighting a dragon or, you know, abolishing a witch or
abolishing.
I don't know. You know, throwing a crystal ball at somebody, like fighting a dragon, like who knows? Who knows what he was doing in the 80s? But, you know, and then in the 90s, like battling robots and shit, who knows?
Did he ever get to robot dragons or was it just, I mean, on stage, they were robotic dragons, but.
No,
lyric-wise, it was either it went from dragons to robots.
Yeah,
so I was listening to Lock Up the Wolves this morning. Mm-hmm. When I was doing some housework. And
it's a decent album.
The song Walk on Water. So there's a line in there where he says, like, I think you can't walk on water, but then he throws in you can't burn the sun. I was wondering, is that like, I didn't notice any of these ad libs like what I just mentioned, but I was like, is that an ad lib or is it a reference back to this album? Because it's like trying to burn the sun. Well, I guess spoilers, you can't. So if you're hoping at the end of this that they're able to burn the sun, I'm afraid I got bad news for you.
I don't know. I feel like Ronnie had his over the years his wheelhouse, his bag of tricks, so to speak. Yeah. Just like every musician, I think, does. And I mean, that whole genre, like the fantasy genre, there's only so far you can go. And I think, like, maybe in his mind, like, where it went was just, you can't burn the sun. You know, he's probably thinking back like 20 years and he's like, hey, yeah, I'm going to keep that.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember when I tried to burn the sun. Didn't work. So anyway, we got a little ahead of ourselves. What do you think about When She Smiles?
Yes. So that was another really good song, a lot of dynamics in it. I'll give a 3.5 for that one.
All right. I'm on the fence about, I'm going to give this one a 4.5.
Woo!
Really liked it. Really liked the arrangement, the all the cool stuff that they did, the orchestrations, the background, everything is clicking on this album for me so far. And this is to me just a really interesting song. Well done. Almost toyed with giving it a 5. Maybe if I listen to this a few more times this week, it might bump up to a 5 for me, but I really, 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 really digging it.
Good.
Still not sure if I've ever heard it before, but so there you go. All right. The next track up, gotta say, sounds like traditional Elf by its title. There's a few that sound traditional Elf. This one's called Good Time Music. That just, if this doesn't start with a rollicking, bright piano boogie woogie sound, then I'm gonna eat my shoes. All right. Not quite what I was expecting.
All right, you only have to eat the laces. Because it is a piano, but it's not rollicking.
No, not rollicking. Love the feeling of it, though. It's great. So they recorded this album, and this came out in June of 1975, and in August the first Rainbow album came out. So
yep.
I think this album just gets completely lost.
Yeah.
It's a shame, because this is damn good.
I mean, you got, you know, the former guitarist of Deep Purple releases his first solo album versus goes up against this.
Right. And they were both coming out on Purple Records. Who are they gonna push? You know, well, I guess like it was a subsidiary, was Oyster or whatever for Ritchie, but it's probably the same business arm or whatever.
I mean, even if they marketed it like, you know, a few months later, is like all of the musicians that were on the new Blackmore album at the time, that would have generated some interest.
Yeah, just slap a sticker on those albums in the shops. Boom, featuring the legendary musicians behind the new Rainbow. And then they'd have to peel them all off like a few months later when they were all fired. What a mess. Great solo from Mickey. This to me has all of the energy of that first David Coverdale album, that like same I know there's a lot of the same players there, but it's got that same just happy, upbeat energy.
Something you'd hear like a bar band playing, you know, like, hey, hit it, Billy, you know, like. Yeah, Yeah, and just really like you said, like upbeat. It's kind of like a slower tempo tune, but it's like, you know, makes you bob your head and be like, yeah. Yeah, let's all share a pint. A pint of lager.
Be British.
Let's all share a pint of lager.
It's not even a British band. Let's have a pint of that there lager, good man.
I'm not even doing a British accent. I'm like, let's all have a pint, mate.
I'm glad. I would have been very disappointed if you said that was my best shot at a British accent.
No, you don't want to hear it. Freshen your drink, Gardner.
Perfect.
Like a 19th century bar wench.
Mickey is killing it on the song. It's making me sad because it's like they're really hitting their stride here. This is like what I was hoping the first two Elf albums would deliver on. Not that they're bad albums by any means, but
no, but this is better.
This next level. A huge step up.
A little like kind of flange going on here on the background.
And on the guitar? Oh, they're in a little.
No, I feel like it's like the whole track. Hmm. No, it was very subtle, but I heard it though.
Nice. So I'm looking at you there with your tank top on, and Steve Colwell was commenting on the picture. I think this is the album art that for the episode that came out today. And he was very impressed with your rock and roll over tattoo. So I think
I'm impressed that at this angle that he knew that it was a rock and roll over tattoo.
Yeah, I think he's a big fan. So I think he saw that and was very impressed with it. It is a very nice tattoo. It's very well done, covering up a previous two attempts. What was the second one?
it was the Paul Stanley Rose, and there was a lightning bolt which was below it.
I don't remember the lightning, but was that the same time as the rose?
It was a little bit after, but I was never happy with the placement or how it came out. I was younger. I listened to I told the tattoo artist what I wanted. I was young. I didn't listen to him. I'm like, okay. And then I wound up getting something stupid that I hated because it just didn't look right. But ultimately, like getting older, like even if it was just the rose to like, you know, was Paul Stanley had the open face rose tattoo on his right shoulder, having something a little bit different or like, not really original because everybody's got a kiss tattoo, but not having the same tattoo as Paul is like, felt to me a little bit more original having my own thing. Like on there rather than copying him, you know what I mean?
Yeah. That's very nicely done. Looks perfect.
I paid enough for it.
you do a cover up job. My wife's cousin has a tattoo of something on her like ankle. It's like I can't even remember. It's like a mermaid or a unicorn or something. And it's nice. Yeah. And like we were having like a few drinks with her one summer, like, and, you know, we had all of our shoes off and she was telling us it was covering up a tattoo she got when she was 13. Oof. She went to I think she was in like Jamaica or something. And she just went into it. I don't know why she was there at 13 by herself. She must've been there with somebody, but she went in there and was basically like, hey, I want a tattoo. And she got a tattoo of a frog smoking a cigar. This is why fantastic. They don't let 13-year-olds get tattoos. They probably shouldn't let 18-year-olds get tattoos, to be honest, because you know, you're covering up tattoos you got when you were an adult and you already regret.
Yeah, I mean, I was probably like at least, I mean, not much older than 18. I was probably 20 when I got those, but you know, and then it wasn't until I was like, just a few years ago, it was like, actually I'm lucky because I was thinking about it because it was the summer before COVID And I actually had to get it done in two sessions. Not that it was that complex, but
it's that new.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. When I booked it, the guy realized, he was like, you know what? I didn't book enough time for this. Like we'll have to do it another session. Now imagine if that was during COVID, and then in the 2 weeks from then until then, I just had half a tattoo on
for
my
two
arm.
Years.
I would have been pissed. Are you kidding me? I was thinking about that the following summer. Like, I'm so glad that I did it. And like the summer of, like, I think it was the summer of 2018 or 19.
That would have been great. Yeah. Like 2 years later, you get the other half. You're just wearing long sleeve shirts all the time.
I mean, wasn't that bad, but there was like, it was, you know what I mean? Like it would have been like passable, but it wouldn't have been like, I would have definitely been unhappy. it would have made the pandemic even worse. It's like, and on top of it, I got this unfinished tattoo here.
Then the guy dies and you're like, oh shit, his business, he goes out of business. You're like, what am I going to do?
I got to have somebody else finish it. It's like, holy.
Some talented person could come. They come off and they do it, but it's like slightly bigger scale. So it's like, it's sticking up on the edge a little. The circle is a little too big.
And then I just have to get my arm amputated. It's like, it's all over.
Oh man. All right. So good time music, John. What do you think of that track?
Well, the master of just bringing it right back to where we need.
Yeah, there was
to
no segue. I was just like, let's get back to good time
music. I had a good time with good time music. Mm-hmm. So a good enough time to give it a 3.5. All right. Definitely what I expect and like from Elf, and they did a great job of it on this album. Like it's continuing along the theme of just this being superior of the three Elf albums.
Absolutely. I had a slightly better time, so I'm going to give it a 4. Woo. Really enjoyed that tune. Loved Mickey's two solos there. And I like what I was really expecting was to go right back to Carolina Crowny Ball, like have that whole like rollicking piano, and they didn't take it there, which is good, because mm-hmm. I think I've had enough of that, and I think they proved they can do that and they can do it well. But I really enjoyed that. All right, ready to flip this record over to side two? Oh. I was like, he's miming some. He flipped his record over to side two.
I literally flipped it.
Still in the sleeve. Okay, here we go. The next song is called Liberty Road. Nice.
Yep, still keeping on the up-tempo rockers. I like that this album has incorporated the guitar and the piano a little more seamlessly together. It's like more guitar heavy, but the piano is not pushed to the side.
And I think maybe that's part of it. Maybe it's just the production of the piano is such that it's not so dominating.
Well, it's like, you know, the other couple of albums just felt like it was like way more like almost like it was like hardly a guitar in it, which is not a bad thing, but it's, you know, this is like nice balanced.
Like it could be like a Bob Seger song or something.
You know, we were talking earlier today when we were texting about how female vocalists have added a lot to like classic rock over the years.
Yeah, we were. Rich said that thing about the woman who did Gimme Shelter.
Yeah. I definitely think that, like, you know, Ronnie on his own is good, but without those backing vocalists, like, the songs wouldn't have as much oomph behind them.
It elevates it to such a different level.
Yeah.
Hopefully they were better treated and better paid than... I mean, not that their impact on all music and art culture is quite the same as the woman who did Gimme Shelter, but I hope they were they were obviously utilized a lot on all of these albums.
Also, in reference to the solo, I feel like Steve Edwards might have been influenced by Ritchie a little bit.
Well, you figure they were touring with Purple for years. By this point, they would have been going around with Purple for like 3 years or something, opening for them. So,
because he kind of did that fast trend picking in the solo. I mean, that was a big Ritchie staple around this time in his playing.
Down, down, his favorite thing to say. This is one of those songs I could definitely hear in classic rock radio, but obviously did not. I don't think they even released any singles off of this.
Nice.
Cool.
Liberty. It would have been a lot of fun if Ronnie had taken Helen Chappelle and Liza Strike to like the Dio band. He like called them up. It's like, hey, you want to do some, you want to do backups on a Holy Diver?
Be great. I could just hear them like under him, like a Rainbow in the Dark or something, you know, Rainbow.
You know, that was, yeah. Imagine if they did that instead of the keyboard part.
If they just went,
I didn't mean that, but that's actually funnier. No, it's like,
that would definitely not be an improvement. But the but having them sing under him, like in the chorus, would actually work well on that song.
Yeah, I'm saying, yeah, that would be that'd be something.
It's a heavy song, but it could work with vocals. Or what do you think of Liberty Road?
Another good one. 3.5.
All right, I will give this one a 3.5 as well. Really, I like that. Dun, 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 dun. Like that just sounds like such a, that could have been a staple of classic rock radio, but the marketing dollars behind it, I suppose. All right, the first song featuring the word boogie is appearing next. So once again, I am anticipating some boogie woogie piano, but we'll see. Mr. Sewell has surprised me more than once on this album. So let's hear it. It's called Shotgun Boogie. Wow. This is not what I was expecting. Wow. Nice bass line by Gruber there. Wow. You're grabbing Gruber now. That's great. Nice dynamics there.
Yeah, I don't even want to talk because this is so good. You hear the guitar in the background too?
Yep, just vamping on those chords. Nice.
Yeah, baby.
Wow. Everybody got a little turn to shine on this one. It's like the shortest song on the album, too. So much going on dynamically, it's great. You know what's weird? That song goes all over the place. It kind of like that song sounds like it could be something like David Lee Roth did on like his first solo album. You know what I mean? Like
it's true.
It's got that same like cockiness to it, just like the like very very self confident, like changing up the rhythm.
Yeah, but the scatting is it?
if this had been a big song, like David Lee Roth definitely would have thrown that on his album.
Oh man, yeah, that's I never thought of that, but yeah.
All right, Shotgun Boogie, what do you think?
That's definitely a standout track, so I'm giving that one a 4. I mean, it's another one where not only is there a lot going on dynamically, but it's like there were a lot of areas in there where it could have gone on like way longer. Like I can't think of anything examples, but I think you probably know what I'm talking about. We've heard some songs that have gone in that direction and it's just been like, you see the running time is like 8 minutes and you're like, ugh. It's like, but I mean, they
was got the opposite. In. You're like, oh man, it's almost over.
Yeah. They got in, they got out. It was like, you know, like a shotgun, boom, you know, the song was like, what, for the 4 minutes long, done. Mm-hmm. See ya.
They threw like a little drum break in there, but it was like 8 bars. So, you know, like everything was very tastefully handled.
Exactly. So, I mean, that was a lot of these songs, like this one especially, and I think maybe Good Time Music is another one. They just give me that bar band type of vibe, you know, like you're going to see a local band perform in like, you know, a bar, small venue, something like that. And like, I can just picture like the small stage, the low lights, you know, Ronnie just walking around snapping his fingers while the solos are going on. Like just walking
around. I picture wearing a tux while he's doing the song. A white tux, not a black one, any color but black.
but you know what I mean? It's like very like accessible, just really good rock music that they're putting out here.
I agree. I also give it a 4 for all the reasons you said. And yeah, it's just, that was a real fun song. Well done. Well executed. Great little solo sections. Excellent. Very dynamically all over the place, which is really cool. And just something you don't hear, you know, I don't want to be an old fogey, but something you don't hear enough in modern music, and more because of the production than the music itself. They don't allow anything to be quiet anymore for any reason. And that just, that's really good stuff. All right, the second to last track on this album is a song called Wonderworld, all one word.
Is that like Blind Man?
Like Blind Man Wonderworld. It sounds like the brightness on the piano has been tuned down a lot on this album. Which is good, because I think for the right track, that bright, bright piano sound can be good, but not maybe working on every track. Touch me, I feel. Take me, I'm real. Sail away into the sun. I'm everyone.
As usual, Ronnie's vocals flawless. Drift away into the night.
And it's great hearing him sing this stuff, like softer stuff, which he's so good at, and was really underutilized at later in his career. He was just that heavy metal power vocalist, which he's also incredibly good at. But
I mean, he definitely had his moments in the later, his later years and later albums. Like, he never really got rid of those dynamics totally, but it was never to this level again.
I'm glad they really utilized Chappelle's strike in St. John, as well as the strings on this album. It wasn't just like brought in for one song. It was peppered throughout the album, done really well.
And the other thing too is that it's not like none of it was used to the effect of like, oh, they have female backup singers. Oh, look, there's an orchestra. It's like it's seamlessly integrated.
Yeah, exactly. Not doing it for the sake of doing it.
Right, like the orchestra is like is gone now. You know what I mean? It's like you don't even notice.
It's Glover's production right there.
Yep, seamlessly fades in and out. I'm a fire, burning higher, trying to burn the sun. There you go.
It's beautiful. I'm a sucker for, you know, delivering the name of the album really late in an album like this. Just like, ah, there's the name of the album. It's not just one of the song titles. And according to this, it wasn't even Martin Ford that conducted. It was his orchestra, so he's probably playing in it. It was conducted by Gavin Wright.
Hmm. Either that or he just lent him out for the weekend.
Well, I know they played on the live Butterfly Ball, but he didn't. He was in the orchestra, but he didn't conduct. He played. He's French horn. Could be the same situation. Well, Martin Beautiful. Said he's got all of his receipts and invoices, so if we need any dates or any information, just look them up. And he said he can go through his old file and find them all, which is pretty cool.
That's nuts.
Have to drop him a line. Hey, how you doing? Let's talk about trying to burn the sun.
Got receipts for Wonderworld?
Yeah, do you have the receipt? How much was the viola player paid for Wonderworld?
That's like next level, like deep dive right there.
Exactly. Yeah, like, we don't want to get into that much detail.
We'll violin strings were $1.50.
It was all done at Kingsway, so this would have been after Gillan purchased Delane Lay and they all recorded there. So okay, Wonderworld. Nice. What do you think about this album? I mean song. We'll talk about the album in a minute.
Yes. Beautiful composition, 3.5. Right. I think the best thing about it, one of the best things about it was, is again, not hugely long, not this big, long production or whatever. And like the piano and the full band and the orchestra, everything just all blended together perfectly. Like we were, you know, talking about during the song, it's not just like, hey, here's the orchestra. It's like, you don't realize that it's just kind of like moving seamlessly in and out of the song. to like great effect. And Ronnie is just masterful here at like his, just his dynamics of his vocals, just, you know, how passionately he sings. And
but it was still almost 5 minutes long, you know?
Yeah, but not
it,
like,
it didn't feel it though.
Right. Right. But you're talking like, you know, like any longer than 5 minutes, I would consider like super long, you know?
Yeah.
Or getting into that territory, like, you know, our next song, but.
For sure. All right. I will give that one a 4. I really liked it. I thought it was great. Great composition, great orchestrations, moved along really nicely. Great stuff. Which brings us to our final track, which is the song Streetwalker. Also one word.
Like how you hear the one single piano, like somebody just flipped on the tape recorder and somebody's just messing around on the piano in the background.
Yep. So yet another song about a prostitute?
Maybe. Almost sounds like they recorded it like a demo or...
Or like it was recorded all on one track, like there was no separation of the tracks.
And maybe they thought like, hey, this is the vibe. We don't want to do another take.
Not completely unexpected. Now it's like a Joe Cocker Band song all of a sudden.
Yeah, this is another one with a great groove coming up. Magic.
There's magic in the way you make me feel like magic. Great bass line. Can't believe it's true. No magic. So spooky in the way you always get me higher.
This is great stuff. Another great groove, like just like Prentice would.
Yep, great ad-libbing by McGee. To do that unaccompanied or accompanied by drums, but it doesn't really count for a vocalist.
Ronnie, he knows what's up.
Nothing for him. That was very Ritchie.
Mm-hmm.
Forget if this guy's sitting on the side of the stage watching Ritchie for how many shows the Elf play with Deep Purple over the years. 50. Gotta pick up a few tricks.
Mm-hmm.
Great guitarist.
Surprised he never
did anything else.
Hmm.
Halfway point through the song, it's like, what other tricks are they gonna have up their sleeves?
Yeah, still not getting sick of it though.
Nope. Back in the club now.
Sort of tickling those ivories.
Smoke-filled bar.
Ronnie's walking around. Hey, anybody here from out of town? Don't forget to tip your waitresses. We'll be here all night, folks. Another show at 10 o'clock.
Another boogie-woogie marathon.
Elf's boogie-woogie marathon. Shows at 7 and 10.
Saturday is at O'Shanahy's Irish pub here.
O'Shanahy. at Shillelagh's. O'Shillelagh's.
They were going to name it that, but they couldn't figure out how to spell it. Every time I want to know how to spell shillelagh, which is more often than you think, I have to Google the most crazy spelling of shillelagh, and it's like, oh, you mean shillelagh? I'm like, thank you, because it's not supposed. It like doesn't make any sense how it's spelled. I usually put like Irish staff or something. There are more G's and H's in it than you'd think. Nice.
Ooh, that's
it's
it.
Weird because you're expecting the stinger, but they faded it out instead.
Yeah. Little fade out, yeah.
Oh my goodness. Streetwalker. All one word.
Streetwalker. We're giving that one a 4.
4. All right.
Yeah. I mean, definitely the longest song on the album. Did not feel like it. Again, like a lot of great dynamics, a great groove in the middle of the song. Mm-hmm. I mean, pretty straightforward. I mean, you listen to the lyrics, it's like, okay, Ronnie's singing about a prostitute. It's like pretty obvious. He's not like, oh, it's a streetwalker, but she's from another dimension.
It's like a power walker. She's wearing like a leotard. She's holding those 2-pound weights in her hands. That's what I thought she was talking about.
I don't know. But that's a lot of great dynamics, great playing, like and like that the first half of the song where there was like that kind of like that groove going on. Mm-hmm. Doesn't get any better.
Nope, it's great. I will give it a 4.2. I think it's a great close to the album. It's a little long, but yeah, they do a lot of cool stuff in that time. It's like a standard blues song, but yet not like a totally contrived blues song. It's mm-hmm. they go some interesting places with it, and you've got some great singing, great playing, nice solos. I mean, what's not to like, huh? That's what I think about Streetwalker.
What's not to like? Ritchie coming in and busting up this band. That's what's yeah, not to the, like.
When they finally are really starting to just really bang on all cylinders, he's like, all right, you're out, the rest of you come with me, we're going to music land and we're recording an album. Ah, shit.
It's like they just finished recording the album, and then like, you know, Steve Edwards is like, "Who's the prick in the hat over here? Like the pilgrim hat? What's going on?"
I think unfortunately he knew exactly who that guy was because he's been playing with them for years. He's like, "Oh boy, I should have seen it coming." Oh boy, yeah. Well, that's Streetwalker, and that's Trying to Burn the Sun. So while John busts out the spreadsheet, we will do something which we, of course, do every episode, and that is to thank who? Our foundation level patrons. Coming in at the $3.33 halfway to evil tier, we have none other than Mr. Raffcaff. At the $3 Nobody's Perfect tier, Peter Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Duncan Leesk, Stuart McCord, Flight of the Rat Bat Blue Light, Ivan Fieldboo. It's a great life in the Norway can. Runar Siemensen. It's a great life in the Norway can. And JJ Stenard. Coming in at the $1 made up name tier, we have the Trying to Never See the Sun, Leaky Mausoleum, Stephen Somerville, the Concerto 1999 Fanatic, Spike the Rock Cat, Hank the Tank, Private Eyes, Ashton Lionel, Spike's Mom, and Blackmore's Tights. Thank you so much to all of you for your generous support of the Deep Purple podcast. We couldn't do it without you. All right, so you know what time it is now? We'll just post it out the spreadsheet. Jingle work has been done.
I had a feeling that you were going to have that ready.
We talked about it after the show, the last show. John wrote the lyrics, well, most of them. It was John's idea.
It was, what was it? Did we record it or were we just saying it after the show?
We were just after the show. Naturally. We were talking. I think it was after the show. Maybe we did it on the show. I don't know. Our listeners will listen and tell us.
But I don't know. I had this sneaking suspicion that you had worked on it and it was going to be ready for this show. I don't know why, but I'm so like glad that you did.
I had like 25 or 30 minutes free the other night. And I was like, I want to see if I can throw something together.
And that's just about as great as I thought it would be.
I can't tell if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
my own spreadsheet fumbling music. Thank you.
All right. All right. So, John, where does Elf Trying to Burn the Sun stack up in the catalog here?
So, much to my delight, it is in the top two thirds of our overall albums here.
The top third, right?
Yes, I'm sorry. The top third. Sorry, I can't math. So our combined rating was 7.88. Little variance. You rated it slightly higher than I did, even though I doled out a 5. I gave some of the other songs a little bit lower. Doesn't mean that I like them any less. Of course. Just not as outstanding as some of the other ones, but overall just a fantastic album. Definitely belongs up here. Mm-hmm. Sandwiched between Down to Earth by Rainbow and Love Hunter by Whitesnake. So I think that's a very nice place for it to be. Just looking at some of the other albums around it, they're definitely some of our other favorites, so I'd say that we got this one right.
Yep, and Private Eyes is a few above it, busting out for Rosie there.
Little busting out the spreadsheet.
Right. I think that's a good place for it. Definitely a great album. Definitely it'd be interesting to see where's the next Elf album on this list. It's down there a ways. Oh, that's the first Elf album.
Yeah, it's definitely not up.
Oh, actually, we ranked the first Elf album a little higher than Carolina County Ball.
I think it's actually it's kind of funny that this Elf album is next to a Rainbow album, but it's next to a different Rainbow. It's a non-Ronnie. non-Ronnie Rainbow.
So this album ranks 30, is number 30, and the second and the next Elf album down, which is the debut, is coming at 74. So
wow.
So yeah, quite a stretch between them of the 88 albums that we've reviewed so far, or 87, sorry, that we've reviewed so far on the show. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. Well, I did some searching to find information. I looked in Ronnie's book. I looked in the biography on Ronnie by James Curl. I looked all over the place, but really could not find much information at all about this album. So I got like nothing as far as insights or reviews or chart, anything. Like I'm sure it didn't chart at all, but yeah, not much to add as we close out the episode on any additional information about this. The only thing that I could really find was a few random little blurbs here and there, and then of course like even the Wikipedia entry has basically nothing on it. So it's just like, this is the third Elf album, here are the songs, Ronnie James Dio is on it, and it's like, okay. So if you've got anything we missed on this album or anything you think's worth pointing out, let us know. But yeah, really fun album. Great. Had a great time listening to it with you. And, we'll have to do this again next week.
Yeah. It's always a lot of fun listening to, an album that we either like look forward to, or that we know is going to be good, we think is going to be good, or just has, you know, a musician or somebody on it that we're like really excited about, you know, like, I think anything with Ronnie, I'm just like, I'm excited, but I was definitely, I know that I like this album, and I think it was on the Carolina County Ball episode. I talked about this one and said, yeah, this is the album that I like the best. So, you know, these are definitely, maybe the albums that I would like the least are probably the most interesting episodes, because then you'll get my most scathing commentary. But but these I enjoy the most, just because it's such a pleasure to sit down and listen to them with you, and you know, hear some things that, you know, I don't hear, because like I've said before in other episodes, like this is like the first time, like probably in ages, that I hear a lot of these songs with headphones on. So I pick up a lot of stuff that I've never heard or haven't heard in a while, you know?
Yeah. Aside from my playlist that I used to listen to, Clean in the Church, I mean, most of the stuff was just listening to on regular speaker. So you definitely get a new appreciation for it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, great stuff. It was really fun listening to this one. And you know, the sun set on the Elf years, and Ronnie went on to bigger and greater things, but yeah, this is still a huge important part of his catalog and some great stuff. And sadly he's been gone from us for 12 years now, and gone but not forgotten. I mean, I'd say his legacy and everything is stronger now than it was 10-20 years ago. I mean, we knew who he was, and hard rock metal fans knew who he was, but I think like people outside of even that genre know at least the name, or know some of his stuff, even if they're not familiar with his work. He's just become a legend, and rightly so, for having absolutely one of the greatest voices and great songwriting and all that. So
undeniable.
Rest in peace there, Ronnie, and Johnny, we'll see you next week.
All right,
later.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple Podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.